Howdy, Dr. Will Wong here, and welcome to tonight's edition of the Essentials of Life and Wellness. If you've been following my work, you know that there was a period in my life when I was considered the world's most experienced microcurrent electrotherapy therapist. And yes, I know that, and a buck and a half will get me on a bus somewhere, or a cup of coffee. But I've come across a really interesting electrostim unit and a sister unit to that particular unit that I have to tell you about. These are available from Motivation and Muscle. If you go to Motivation and Muscle and click on the picture of Eric Fiorello doing bench presses with two 150-pound dumbbells, it'll take you to where the electrostim units are. And these units are very, very, very interesting. The electronic stimulation that I have been known for has all been microcurrent stimulation. This is not microcurrent. This is millicurrent stimulation. And the difference between these units and all the units that I've used before is that the microcurrent actually reads data from the body and then puts back data into the body to try to recharge the cells back to their normal electrochemical state. This particular microstim unit, or rather this particular electrostim unit that I've been using now from Eric, is tuned to a particular frequency. That particular frequency is very much in tune with the magnetic and electronic frequencies we all swim in, that of the Earth. It doesn't carry data, but it does change the chemistry of the cells to a more positive one, to a more homeostatic one. And in so doing, it relieves pain, it assists with sleep, it does a number of things. The sleep thing is especially nifty, because for folks who can't go to sleep, who have trouble sleeping, the sleep units are a wonder. The sleep units are also used for anti-pain, for tissue regeneration, and for anti-aging. But you can read all about that once you get on the website. The particular unit that I'm using is their electronic stim unit, and it is specifically a pain unit. As you know, I need a partial shoulder replacement in my right shoulder. My right shoulder has the humeral head worn down about half or three quarters of the way. In other words, I've got a flat tire in my shoulder. Due to my punching trees with bags of sand and rocks hung on the trees for the better part of 50 years. My aim in punching the tree was to develop iron fist. And yes, I can make a 20-foot oak or a 40-foot pine tree shake with one punch. I can make it shiver. I have never had to hit anyone more than once in any of the numerous fights I used to be in back when I was younger. But all that training, along with the 50 years of martial arts, 50 years of weightlifting, 50 years of all the other activities that I've been doing. Actually, the worst stuff I ever did was the 12 years I did gymnastics for, and then I taught gymnastics. That was awful. That probably took more of a toll on my shoulder than anything else I've ever done. But all that accumulated stuff has come, and it has worn my shoulder down so that I need a partial replacement. I need a hemicap replacement, and I'm just waiting to get that done, along with some stem cell therapy. But I'm specifically using this unit that Eric is providing against pain. The pain in the shoulder wakes me up at night. The pain in the shoulder gets in the way of my activities of daily living. My own microcurrent units, of which I have various ones, including the world's best ones, have been okay at relieving the pain a little bit. Haven't healed anything. They haven't fixed anything. The pain relief hasn't been long-standing. Some minutes, a few hours at the most. So I wanted to try something else. The science behind this new electrostim unit was really fascinating, so I gave it a go. From the first session on, pain was minimized. Matter of fact, the pain was so minimized, I began to feel all the other places that I hurt in my body, which is typical of surgery patients when they have, for example, hip surgery. The doctor will walk in to see the patient at the hospital, and he'll ask the patient, "How does your hip feel?" And the patient says, "My hip feels great, but now I got a backache." No, you've always had a backache. But the thing was, your hip hurt worse than your back, so That's all you felt was your hip. So once the pain in my shoulder was relieved via this new electrostim, I began to feel all the other aches and pains that I've got around the torso and around the back and around the knees and wherever else. So I am now going to go use that unit on everywhere else. My point is, if you're looking for a non-drug way of dealing with chronic pain, if you've got the type of injuries that really do need to be fixed, but you can't get them fixed yet, and even if you've had them fixed and they still hurt, give this electrostim unit a try. If you have trouble sleeping, if you want to regenerate during sleep, if you want to have deep, restful sleep, if you want to have anti-aging therapy while you sleep, go to motivationandmuscle.com. Motivationandmuscle.com. Right there at the top of the page, you'll see a picture of Eric doing incline bench presses with 150-pound dumbbells. Click on that picture, and that will take you through to the Electrostim site. Order your units. I can't say enough good things about them. And let's now get to your questions. The first question reads, Dear Dr. Wong, I'm a 65-year-old male in good health, weigh in at 180 pounds, work out, and eat a healthy diet. Also taking your Zymessence 3 times a day, and taking the Antinescence Max and the Prostagy 2 times a day. My problem is I have to get up 2 or 3 times a night to pee and have to go frequently throughout the day. This has been going on for 5 years. The doctor checked my prostate and said it was slightly enlarged, but not so much to cause a concern. Any suggestions? I'm desperate to be able to sleep through the night. And my answer is howdy. Today's docs have forgotten what they were supposed to have learned in school. With prostate issues, you feel the urge to urinate during sleep, but when you get up and go, the bladder isn't full, and you only let out a little bit. A full bladder a few times a night is a sign of adrenal exhaustion. Matter of fact, it's the number 2 sign of adrenal exhaustion we look for when diagnosing. Getting lightheaded when quickly arising from a chair or a bed and having a drop of more than 10 millimeters of mercury in a blood pressure reading between laying back and then immediately standing is the number 1 symptom we look for. Adrenal exhaustion patients are always dehydrated because they don't make aldosterone, the adrenal hormone that holds the salt that in turn holds in the water. Until 1993, adrenal exhaustion was treated with adrenal cortex extract, either as a nose spray or as a capsule. In 93, the FDA banned ACE, ACE, with little or no explanation. Seems the medical industry wants adrenal exhaustion patients to turn into full-blown Addison's patients, as the medical industry makes tons more money from that. Being an adrenal patient myself, I have tried every adrenal support supplement product made for 2 or 3 decades with zero success. So when I got into the nutritional industry, a PhD pharmacologist and I developed Adrenal Vita Amino Complex, which is the closest thing to the old ACE medications we can get. Start by taking 2 capsules 2 times a day. You'll note getting up less to urinate at night within a week. Take that dose for 3 to 4 weeks, then drop the morning dose to 1 capsule and keep the evening dose at 2. See if the results still hold it. If they do, stay there. If they don't, go back to 2 and 2. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. And the next question reads, Dear Dr. Wong, I will order a bottle or 2 of the Zymessence this weekend. This will be my first try of your product, and I'm looking forward to trying it. I'm having some hiatal hernia flare-ups with acid reflux and chest congestion and cough. I'm wondering if the Zymessence would help. And my answer is howdy. Nope. The Zymessence won't help with the hiatal hernia, which is an opening in the diaphragm for the esophagus that is too large, and the stomach then gets sucked up into the chest cavity by the negative pressure there. Most of medicine, most internists, and the drug firms want us taking anti-acid drugs for life. That acid spills up into the esophagus from the stomach, causes esophageal rings, which must be stretched via minor surgery. And the procedure will always need to be redone in a few years because the acid continues to attack the lining of the esophagus. Internists make a grand plus with each stretching they do. It's one of their bread and butter surgeries. Mechanical problems demand a mechanical solution. In all honesty, the best thing you can do to stop, I mean stop the acid reflux, and cut short the development of the esophageal rings is to see a general surgeon, not your internist, and have the hiatal hernia fixed. End of problem. No more antacids. No future trips to the internist every few years. My barber, who is in his 70s, has had over 5 of these ring stretching procedures done just in the last few months because his acid reflux is so bad. All of them were needless. If the docs would have only spoken to him earlier about repairing the opening in the diaphragm, the procedure is mostly same-day surgery, relatively minor, and it will save you years of suffering. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. And on to the next question, which reads, Dear Dr. Wong, any suggestions on bloating? It seems that every time I eat a small amount, I feel very bloated. Next morning, I have extreme gas and I go to the bathroom. I have ordered your armored acidophilus. Do you have any suggestions? And my answer is, howdy. A question and 2 suggestions. First question. Do you let your dog lick and kiss you in the mouth? Sounds silly, but most folks who get H. pylori get it from their dogs by doing exactly that. It sounds like you're fermenting. There are 3 reasons for that normally. 1, undigested food decaying in the gut. 2, H. pylori. 3, yeast infection. So my suggestions are these. Try taking one of the zymescents you already have with your meal and see if that helps. If it does, then keep at it. When we get our digestive enzymes back in stock, try taking those as it will be less expensive than using a zymescent as a digestive. Then, get on 1/4 to 1/2 a teaspoon of the armored acidophilus 2 to 3 times daily. This is hitting it hard. It takes 8 to 16 weeks to recolonize the gut with good bacteria, so have at it for 2 or 3 months and see if it helps. Look at your tongue. If it is heavily coated tan or white, then also add our candescence at 1 or 2 teaspoonfuls 2 times daily to actively kill the yeast and also help to recolonize. If none of that works, find a doc who can test for H. pylori via the breath and get the test done. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. Now, for those of you asking why the test has to be done via the breath, is because the waste product of H. pylori is ammonia. And when they're breeding ammonia in your intestines, if you do the breath test, that extra spike in ammonia will show up. Now, a 38-year-old fellow sent me a very long email on his Peyronie's syndrome. If you're not familiar with Peyronie's, it's the bent nail syndrome where the penis takes a severe bend. It's actually painful. And this fellow's email covered various aspects of when he has pain, how much pain he has, when the pain is worse, what he's doing when the pain is worse, that there's a palpable mass of scar tissue on the penis, what he's done, what he's taken, absolutely everything to do with the situation that he can think of, remember, or whatever, because he's very concerned, and that's understandable. And my answer is, howdy. Sounds like something did damage to your tunica. Now, I'll stop here and say that the tunica is the tube of epithelial tissue that surrounds the spongy tissue of the penis. It's just underneath the muscles. And by the way, if you didn't know the penis had muscles, there are 3 or 4 of them. There's the ischiocavernal, the bulbocavernal, and the pubococcygeal. The first 2 wrap around. The last one, the pubococcygeal, goes from the top innermost portion of the shaft to the pelvis, and it's the muscle that pulls you up into a full erection. The other muscles fill you out and elongate during the erection while the spongy tissue gets filled and engorged with blood. Okay, that being said, going back to my answer, my questions are these. Have you been using heat from the onset of the injury? Did you use ice at all? And if at all, for how long? Applying heat to a primary phase injury can cause myositis or significance to happen in muscle, where calcium is deposited in soft tissue, Usually contractile tissue, as there are two layers of that under the tunica. This calcium hardens into a painful bony mass, and drawing more swelling to an area via the heat is a primary reason why ice is applied to an injured area during the primary phase of injury, which is the first 72 hours. Since the continuation of the insult will make your injury worse, I also have to ask, do you cycle, either for real or stationary? Do you wear briefs or boxers or jock straps? Get boxers and make sure that they're stretchy as well. Next, how spacious are your trousers in the front? Are your pants flat in the front, or worse still, jeans or scrubs? Get pleated front trousers for daily wear. Also need to warn you against your wife riding on top of you vigorously while making love. Aside from tight underwear, cycling, and chronic masturbation using only one hand pulling to one side, the most common way men get injured tunicas is being ridden, slipping out partially, and the gal coming down hard on a non-fully inserted penis. It bends it, breaks it. Ouch! And then I have to warn you about wearing anything around with a tight crotch. My suggestions are these. From now on, switch from using heat to putting your penis in a bowl of cold ice water no more than 15 minutes, once or possibly twice a day. Zymescence, 2 capsules taken in between meals, 3 times a day. Magscorbate, 1 capsule twice daily, in case you're developing myositis of Vicance, and in case the calcium is still in an ionic or soft state. Having a high level of magnesium floating around the soft tissues can help chelate out the calcium. This is a slow process, but it can help. Use only vitamin E from the 4-Spectrum and AC Grace companies, as all the other vitamin E's you've been using are estrogenic. Also, if you're in practice, know that you will eventually become discouraged with all of the food-based nutrients, i.e. standard process and metagenics. Most newbies into naturopathic and alternative medicine, especially the naturopaths who went to the Southwest School in Tempe, where I used to teach, which is owned by Metagenics, are all for the propaganda and stated positive effects of the food-based nutrients and their treatment programs. But the old-timey docs, and right now I'm not just talking about myself, but a slew of HMDs, NDs, and DCs that I knew 20, 30 years ago who became very disenchanted with the food-based stuff, as it just plain did not work as advertised. With that warning, I'll let time and clinical experience do the actual teaching and proving to you. Hope all these suggestions help. Be well and God bless. Dr. Wong. Now let's see if we can fit in one more question. And the question reads, Dear Dr. Wong, thank you for all the information. I have learned a lot about systemic enzymes through it. I have been taking Wobenzyme N for years, but I'm now interested in your Zymescence, especially for my husband who has hypercoagulation. We have both been through Lyme's disease treatment and are currently on maintenance program. We are hoping my husband's hypercoagulation was due to parasitemia, but now we are thinking it must be due to testosterone supplementation, as it hasn't gone away with the Lyme's treatment. He is currently on heparin, but we wish to do something more natural. The only way we know he has hypercoagulation is by observation. When receiving IV therapies, his blood would coagulate even in the catheter. When it was pulled out, his blood hung like snot. He immediately felt the positive effects of the blood thinning of the heparin. So now we know we have an issue to deal with. Of course, we were working with a practitioner, but since you have so much experience with the enzymes, I was hoping you would have some advice as to the approach we should use. And my answer is, howdy. Unless the Wobenzyme dose is low, which is really easy to do with the Wobenzyme, the enzyme should be dealing with the waste and debris parasites leave behind, and the enzyme should actually be lysing away at the parasites themselves. For example, systemic enzymes eat and kill serious heartworm infections in dogs in just a few months. But it's the type and dose of enzymes that makes all the difference. The enzymes should also be dealing with the hypercoagulation of the blood, as it lyses away adhesion molecules and fibrin that thicken the blood. Now, this will happen unless chronic dehydration is had. The chronic dehydration will in itself hypercoagulate blood. Mucus Pharma, the makers of Wobenzym, has changed ownership 3 times and modified their formula and their raw material suppliers, which is a super important point, twice since I fronted for Wobenzym 18 years ago, so I have no idea as to the effectiveness of their product at present. What is his daily dose of the Wobenzym? Unless polycythemia vera has been diagnosed, the testosterone making of red blood cells is not to blame for his hypercoagulation. So my questions are these. How often does he get up at night to urinate? Does he get dizzy when arising quickly from a bed or a chair? Is he generally run down? When he drinks water especially, but any liquids in general, do they seem to go out as fast as they go in? Have any tests been run for his kidneys, i.e. blood, urea, nitrogen, creatine, glomerular filtration rate, and urinary output? Have any of those been done? Is he have any blood pressure issues? Does he take any blood pressure medication? What is he taking to kill off the parasites, and how long has that therapy been going on? There are long ways and some very short ways around the barn for parasite infections. Most docs, allopathic and natural, take the long ways. Are you and he organic vegetarians, such as sushi eaters or raw food folks? Have you ever consulted with Dr. Sue Massey, naturopath of New Jersey? She cured herself of Lyme's in the mid to late 90s and has the largest stock of clinical experience in curing the disease that I know of. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. Now, this gal answered back, and she said that her husband indeed gets up several times a night to go urinate, which, again, if you remember the first question we dealt with on this show, is indicative of adrenal exhaustion. Now, over and above the overmaking of red blood cells, he's severely iron deficient. So not only does he have dehydration thickening up his blood, his body is trying to make more red blood cells to compensate for the fact that it doesn't have enough iron to make fully functional red blood cells that can adequately carry oxygen. And lastly, their systemic enzyme just ain't working at all. Not at the doses that they're taking. So, my suggestion was to take Zymescence at 2 capsules, taken in between meals, 3 times a day. Now let's talk about some points in the news. Some very, very, very interesting research has been released showing that Viagra, Sildenafil, reduces the danger of colorectal cancer by 50. You heard me, 50%. It turns out that in the regulation of cyclic GMP, cyclic guanosine monophosphate, which is an intracellular calcium regulator, it helps the epithelial tissue to maintain itself and also prevents bowel inflammation. So there's another application. Now, it turns out that that pesky little thing called PDE5, the enzyme that destroys nitric oxide. Remember, nitric oxide is the blood gas that vasodilates, that brings blood everywhere. The initial reason why the things like Viagra were created from Cnidium monnier, which is a lichen that grows on rocks in China, the initial reason was to increase the circulation to the brain of Alzheimer's patients and increase the circulation to the heart of cardiac patients. They just found that it worked better on the penis than it did on the heart and the brain, so that's what they went for, because that's where the major amount of money would be. But now they're beginning to apply this where it's supposed to be applied, which is everywhere else. So they found that the downregulation, cyclic GMP, and the downregulation of nitric oxide helps to cause colon cancer, helps to cause rectal cancer, and helps to cause cancerous polyps in the intestines. So if you upregulate cyclic GMP, if you get rid of and control a good bit of the effects of the PDE5 enzyme, bingo, you've got beneficial effects to epithelial tissue. And folks, not only will this help your colon and your intestines, as I said, it will help your brain and your heart, because that's what they were originally meant to do. If you combine this, the Viagra, if the Viagra works for this, so will anything else in the same class. The Cialis, the whatever other drugs there are, the Levitra. if you combine this with our nitric oxide producing supplements, like the arginine EE with TMG, which we don't have in stock now, which we are going to probably change to DMG, TMG, and make it even stronger. If you combine the drugs, which are fairly safe, the Viagra has some side effects with sight, and it isn't really the drug that's doing it, it's actually the blue coating on the pill that does it. But if you combine the anti-PDE5 drugs with the pro-nitric oxide supplements, all of a sudden, you've got a 1-2 effect. You're creating tons of nitric oxide. You're down-regulating PDE5. You're up-regulating cyclic GMP, and you'll be happier all around. And on that note, I wish you all God's blessings. Be well, and I'll chat with you again next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you for joining Dr. Wong this evening for today's edition of the Essentials of Life and Wellness. If you have any questions about today's show, or if you would like to ask Dr. Wong any other health-related question, you may send an email to radio@drwong.us. That's radio at drwong.us. Or telephone him at 940-325-2147. The products mentioned in today's show, as well as all of the other products Dr. Wong recommends, can be purchased online at docspreferred.com. That's www.docsprefer.com. Or you can speak with a customer service representative at 940-325-2147. Dr. Wong also has an extensive natural health website filled with articles written in Dr. Wong's own unique and easy-to-understand style that discuss natural remedies for some of today's most common and debilitating chronic conditions. You can find these articles at drwong.us. That's www.drwong.us. Until next time, we hope you have a safe and healthy week. Be well, and God bless.